out of sorts and not very great. Or your mum or your sisters might be going through that as well. So that's good to realise. Another good thing to realise about women is that because we have this cycle of hormones that repeats itself every single month, when the body is preparing to release an ovary, an egg from the ovum, there's a hormone called estrogen, and it's kind of like a happy hormone. It's kind of nature's way that women generally, when they're about to ovulate, have this happy hormone coming through the body, and that's when they're more likely to feel like they've got a good hair day, they feel like spring cleaning the pantry, and you know, life's good. And then when they get towards the end of their cycle, when the happy hormone's drained away and their body's preparing to menstruate, they often might have a couple of days where life just is a bit harder. And they're finding, you know, the mess in their house that didn't make them cranky last week is driving them ballistic this week, and they're finding it a bit harder. So that's a good thing for women to be aware of, and it's a very good thing for people who love women to be aware of as well. Okay. But periods are a normal part of life for girls. It means they're growing up and one day may be able to conceive and carry a baby. Okay, what about girlfriends? Very attractive young couple here. Okay, you might begin to feel your attitude and thoughts about girls changes. You're maybe not so worried about girl germs as you used to be. And you might find yourself feeling attracted to a particular girl. It might make you feel a bit embarrassed. It's normal to feel attractions, and it's your emotions and senses practicing. It's what you do with these thoughts and feelings that count. So we talked earlier about how, at the moment, your parents have created a place of belonging for you, and you're on this journey towards getting to a point in life where you can create a place of belonging for others, for children and friends and all that sort of thing. And so you just have a natural process of starting to look outwards from your family. You don't leave your family behind. They're an anchor for you. But you start looking for people who share your values, and you start being attracted to people outside of your family. So just like if you feel, every time you feel angry, you don't go punch someone. Also, every time you feel an attraction to someone doesn't necessarily mean that you act on that attraction. And it takes time and judgment to work out how to integrate all these things. But in terms of having girlfriends, you might find when you get to high school that there's a bit of pressure to have a girlfriend because it's kind of a cool thing to do. Basically, it's something you need to talk to your family about, what they think about it. But it's important that you learn how to be friends with girls, and we'll talk tomorrow about some important skills about just being a friend. Having many friends, some of whom are female, will help you get comfortable talking to girls. And so as I said, it's a family thing. You discuss with your parents about girlfriends. But just one in my little bit of advice, which you can take or leave, is that most people hope that they will meet somebody that they can partner with and be with for the rest of their life. And we know that for a lot of people it doesn't always work out that way. But that's a hope that most people have, is that they'll meet someone, that they'll settle down, and they'll be able to be together for a long time. So that could be decades and decades. And you only really get one decade of being a teenager and a young adult. So it's a really important time for you to learn who you are, what you're interested in, what you want to do in your life, have lots of different friends who can help you get to know yourself better. And sometimes having an exclusive relationship can be quite intense and absorb a lot of emotional energy and psychological energy. So my advice is there's no big rush to get into a really serious exclusive relationship, and being a teenager is a really important time to get to know yourself. But as I said, that's something to have a chat to your parents about, what they think about that issue. Okay, some of this is a bit tongue-in-cheek. 5 things to know about girls. Girls prefer to be called beautiful than hot or sexy. Well, that's true. They might giggle if you say that they're sexy or hot. That's probably better sort of language to use about, you know, wheels on a car or something. But most girls will value boys who are respectful, who just are interested in them as a person. It's better to say stuff like, you know, you look really nice in that jumper, or have you got a new hairstyle? Your hair looks very nice today. Or great goal you kicked at soccer, or ask her about what she thinks about stuff and be interested in what she is interested in life. Girls can be more sensitive to words, so sometimes the sort of jokes you might have with your mates who are boys might not go down the same or quite as take 30. But as I say, that's only because everyone else has gone and got in the car and left her to do all the stuff that nobody else thought to do. Isn't that right? Yes. Okay. All right. We've got a quick whip through cyber safety. We've got 10 minutes left. Okay. It's really important to encourage your children to talk to you about what they're doing online, and as well as concerns or troubles. Okay, three main, this is all kind of common sense, but it's good to go over it. Three main dangers online for kids. One is that negative social situations can have the capacity to reach into every area of your child's life. So in the good old days, we might have had someone who was mean to us on the bus, but then we got to school and we could forget about them. Or there was someone who was mean to us in the playground, but when we got home, we could just forget about it. But now, if a child is connected all the time socially through social media, negative things can be affecting them all the time. So it's really important for us as parents to insist on some downtime for our kids, to say, okay, we're all putting our phones away at 8 o'clock and no more texting, no more checking up or whatever on your friends. Obviously, children can be exposed to unsavoury material online, and, you know, there used to be the strange danger. I remember the strange danger with the flashing car when I was a kid. The stranger danger now is much more serious. People who are nowhere near our children can access them through social media while they're in your home. So we really need to be aware of it. Something that makes me quite cranky as a parent in Australia is that our government, in its wisdom, has left a massive pressure on us to be able to help our kids navigate this. In the UK, if you buy a SIM card, it's automatically locked for adult content. If people that provide adult content have to ask for ID and verify that you're over 18. But in Australia, we've got a big thing about censorship, so the government says basically to us, you have to keep an eye on your kid around the swimming pool because it's an infringement on adults' rights to have, you know, fences around pools, and we're going to build a pool in your school, and we're going to build a pool on the bus, and we're going to build a pool everywhere your kid is. That's basically how it is for parents in Australia, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. But this definitely happens. So I've talked to my kids about stuff. What happens to boys is often girls can get into trouble in chat rooms, but boys, it tends to be more they're playing a game online and someone else is playing on the platform, and they might say to them, hey, I'll play this game with you every 5 o'clock every evening if you turn up, and they might pretend they're some child and start to get to know them, and that's how boys end up in. And it does happen. It's happened in my group of friends. One of the boys, his dad was really sick for months and months, and I saw, so we've taught our kids that if something bad has happened, you can take a screenshot as evidence of a conversation. So my son had done the right thing. He'd taken a screenshot of this conversation, but then he never did anything with it. He didn't quite know how to talk to me. And I found it on the computer, this conversation between him and his friends about who's this weird dude that's hanging around talking to our friend. And so I was able to then tell that boy's mum. But, you know, so my son knew, he obviously had this feeling in his gut that there's something not right here, but then he just didn't quite know what to do next. So we just have to remember, because our kids are very savvy on the internet, we can think that they kind of know more than us, but they're not adults, they don't know how to deal with tricky social situations, so we just need to be having those conversations with them. And boys, if you ever feel just icky, if you've got an icky indicator in your tummy and if something just feels like not quite right, just trust that and talk to a grown-up, okay? Something feels not right. Okay, tips for parents, don't keep devices in the bedroom. So we tell our kids they have to use their laptops. If they're playing games on their phone, it's out in the common areas where we can all ask each other about what we're doing. And as adults, we do the same thing. We have it out in the open and we plug our phones in out in a common area at night. We don't have them in our bedroom. It's easy to go, oh, well, it's my alarm clock and blah, blah, blah. But that's where kids get into trouble, because being connected when they're isolated from their family. No exchange of personal information. People who are not well-intentioned have got very tricky ways of getting information from you. Anyone that you haven't met or hasn't been introduced to your parents or you haven't shaken their hand is not a friend, okay? No matter how friendly they are online, no matter how much you think you know about them, a friend to talk to them about how they use their mobile phone is before they get it, and they're very motivated to know what the rules are and follow them. You can turn off, even if every plan you get has data on it, because the telephone companies want your kids to be using the data, but you can have the data turned off on the phone, and you can also turn it off at, you can ring the telephone company and say, please turn the data off, even though we pay for it, we don't want our child to use it. So we did that with our kids to start with, because we didn't want them on their, you know, on online when they're on the bus and stuff like that. When they come home, they could use the Wi-Fi and get online when they're at home with us. Okay, pornography. Unfortunately, it's just something you absolutely have to talk to your kids about. It's a massive, massive multi-billion dollar industry, and it's not really about sex, it's about money. And it's a massive industry where people are trying to take that really precious, wonderful gift that boys